Brothers and sisters in our Lord Jesus Christ, I want to confess to you today that when it comes to recipes, that I am just a little bit OCD. If I'm going to cook in the kitchen, I want to cook something that's tried and tested, proven to be good, tasty, and wonderful. And then I want to follow the formula. A half cup of this, a teaspoon of that, a quarter cup of this, and voila, perfection. I don't particularly care for the let's experiment method, or even substituting something else for what the recipe calls for because you don't have it in your closet. I remember once I was making a special tilapia recipe that called for fresh parsley. We didn't have any fresh parsley. There wasn't any growing outside. I couldn't substitute grass. So I said to myself, those parsley flakes, not good enough. I'm going to go out and buy the real thing. You know, parsley leaves fresh, pretty expensive. I was a little surprised. I'm pretty sure that I could have just used the dry version of parsley, but I chose to make a special trip to the store, spent that $1 billion so that it would be just right. In the end, I burned it. And Amy smiled as she ate her way through this special dinner that I made, but it really didn't taste very good, I must be honest with you. But I like formulas. Do you guys like formulas? You like them? Raise your hand. Formula people. Jim Schneider, I knew you'd be a formula guy. Today, in our text, St. Paul gives us a recipe for success, a formula for spiritual prosperity. And on this 19th Sunday after Pentecost, it seems like, given the nature of our text, it's a good topic to discuss. But before we do, let me make perfectly clear, right off the bat, that this is not a recipe for worldly happiness. That is, this recipe may not bring to you financial security, world stability, family harmony, a boatload of pleasures. It's not likely to ward off any natural disasters or physical illness. The success it creates is mostly up here and in here, and not so much out there. But perhaps that kind of success is the most important of all. After all, if we're right in here and in here, then other things kind of fall into place. So what is the formula for success? Let's take a look. St. Paul puts it this way. Godliness with contentment is great gain. Well, you say, what exactly does that mean? Let's slice it apart today. Let's look at the components of the recipe, okay? Component number one, godliness. A lot of people think godliness has to do with morality. That is, trying to live God's way. Doing right and good, honesty, integrity. In other words, St. Paul is telling us, great gain, prosperity, is based on how good you are. God will bless you if you live right. Now don't get me wrong, Paul is certainly known to encourage good behavior and action from God's people. But I don't think his intention here is to just tell us, be good, or else you won't prosper. He knows well that the human condition often leads us into times of failure, sinfulness, and that telling a sinful human to produce godliness is like telling an apple tree to produce oranges, or Phil Hillenbrand to be organized in need. It's a paradox. Doesn't happen. Biblical godliness never begins at the command level. Rather, it begins at the relationship level. That is, godliness equals being connected to the God of the universe so much that his priorities become our own. Some years ago, I had a young lady in one of my Concordia classes who absolutely adored one of the American Idol performers. She went to all his concerts, memorized all the details of his life, had met him, written to him, was recognized by him. She did this not so much to earn his favor as she simply thinks that he's fabulous and in every way wants to be connected to the things that he does. This is exactly the way Christians feel about the Lord. Knowing what he did for us by being willing to climb into our skin, walk the road of temptation and poverty, suffering the punishment we deserved, dying the death we should have, and rising from the dead to be our Redeemer and Rescuer, well, let's just say, how can you really be indifferent about that? Can you be ho-hum about the one who pulled you from the clutches of the fire? A godly man, or godly woman, consequently, has a keen sense of who he is. That is, he or she is forgiven and blessed, not because of what he or she did, but because Christ Jesus embraced him or her in the warmth of his love, even when he or she didn't deserve it. He reached out to us with everything he had so that we could be saved. Godliness, then, means connecting to the Savior, immersing ourselves in the words he spoke, the teachings he gave, the body and blood he offered, laying upon his shoulders our burdens and troubles, our hardships and hurts, our doubts and our fears. Godliness means surrender to his will, welcoming his leadership, seeking his input, not just in our faith life, but in every area of life, because ultimately we are his. Godliness, first part of the recipe, immersing ourselves in the wonderful relationship he has created as the Savior who paid the price for our sins. Second piece of the recipe, godliness with contentment equals great gain. What is contentment? A bit of what I said to the kids. Contentment may be seen, in my opinion, in the eyes of the infant. When you look at a baby nestled in the arms of the one it trusts, you see peace. As long as they're cradled in those arms, the world and all its problems pale in distance. I remember once watching a rather dramatic and shocking scene to me. My sister was cradling one of my children in her arms, I think it was David, and all of a sudden she tripped on a step that she didn't see, started to fall. As she did, her arms opened and released David quietly. And he flew right into Amy's arms. I can still kind of see it in slow motion. The stress and fear that my sister Janet had, and the happy, quiet expression that was on David's face as he flew from the warmth of one embrace to the other. There wasn't really much fear there, only trust. My sister broke her ankle, but my child barely winked an eye. For my sister, it was tragedy. For my child, it was transfer. Now, as children grow older, they soon learn the truth that humans are not all-powerful and can't always stop hurt and pain. But God's people know that the Creator of the universe is all-powerful, that he is a refuge and a fortress, a bulwark and a stronghold. He's proven it to us time and time and time again, not only in the stories of the Bible, but in our own experience as his people. And we know well the truth of his sacrifice for us on the cross. And so each new day, as we proverbially fly through the air, contentment means that we believe that God is going to take care of us and to catch us, no matter what. That amid the turbulence of our world and the ups and downs of our journey, and there are many, and some of you are going through some of them right now, that he will never fail. Contentment. Resting secure in the embrace of him who has proven himself trustworthy. So we have godliness plus contentment equals great gain. And what is great gain? Great gain equals confidence, joy, peace, security. Great gain means that we walk not as a people of stress and anxiety and fear and trembling, worried about the next whatever's around the corner, but as a people who know and build their lives upon what our God has done, is doing, and will do. A people who trust in him not because he promises to make everything wonderful and rosy. He never promised that. But because he promises that when we trust in him, he will indeed work all things together for the good of those who love him. That he is in control. That he still has a plan. And that he will not abandon us. Ever. Godliness plus contentment equals great gain. Now, what robs us of great gain is when we let other stuff get into the mixture. A few years ago, actually quite a lot of years ago now, I went to Alaska with a bunch of our youth. And two of our youth really had fun making different special concoctions. I believe it was Scott Wallace and Chad Wayhouse, and they were always making things, and they liked the bread maker. And they made some really tasty bread with the recipe. One day, though, they decided, wouldn't it be fun to mix some things in there? And they used, surprisingly, the taco powder. I gotta tell you, taco bread, not so good. But it was an interesting concoction. Their Jell-O Opus, however, amazing. When in the middle of godliness plus contentment, we add things like materialism, self-pleasure, selfishness, pride, jealousy, anger, lust, greed. Put those things in the recipe and great gain gets replaced with a different end to the formula. Different thing, turns out. Might be fear, might be anxiety, might be doubt. And you know, we do this all the time. What's really comforting is that even when we do that, God still comes to us in our moments of weakness and failure, and he says, you know what? I'm still here. Still committed to you. Still love you. I'm still going to take care of you. Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Take and drink. This is my blood shed for you. You are forgiven. You're cleansed. You're free. So do what I did. Wipe the slate clean. Start fresh. Start new. And we do. Rather than destroying the mixture with jealousy, selfishness, and greed, the Christian, empowered by the Holy Spirit, finds new ways to season the mixture. As St. Paul says in our text, pursue righteousness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. That's good stuff. With God's seasoning, the mixture only gets better and better as we reach out to one another in faith and love. Godliness plus contentment equals great gain. May God bring great gain.